Tonight's talk is one of my favorite kinds of talk. It's actually three of my favorite kinds of talk, all in one. And one is, it's a talk that takes science fiction seriously. It's something that's really important to us here at Long Now. We think that science fiction is actually one of our key ways of thinking about the future and having conversations about the future. And in this talk, we're going to find out it's not just science fiction, but fiction in general that's really important. So it's that favorite kind of talk. Another favorite kind of talk is that it's a work in progress, and it's not just a work in progress. So we have a lot of great talks that are speakers that have written a book and they're doing a book tour, and they've talked about their book in all these different cities. And when they come here, hopefully it's a little bit unique being in this room and with a long-term thinking perspective on it. It's something that's different on a talk that they've given a lot of times. This is the first time this talk has been given. There's maybe one proto version of it that was done, but a lot of the work that tonight's speaker has done is for this audience and for the audience watching later, and for, you know, so future work that's going to be done on this project. So that means it's not finished. It hasn't been. He is very much still working on it. There's going to be a lot of other feedback, and our feedback in this room is actually going to influence where this goes. So no pressure on your Q&A, okay? So that's the second favorite kind of talk, and also just something to keep in mind as we're doing this, not all the answers are there yet, but asking the questions might be really key to the evolution of this idea. And the third favorite kind of talk is, it's a familiar face. James Holland Jones, tonight's speaker. This is actually the third time he's been on this stage. He's talked about diverse topics for us before, and he's an earth system scientist. I said that right, okay, earth system scientist. And he is an anthropologist, biological anthropologist, I believe. I said that right, too. I always say about Jamie, and you're going to really see it tonight, it's this diversity of disciplines, this wide range of expertise, all kind of brought together with a serious rigor to even areas that are not his native ground, as it were. And it's something really special in store for you tonight. So please join me, give a big round of applause for Mr. James Holland Jones, tonight's speaker.
Thanks, Michael. That's really very kind. I have, in fact, given this talk a prototype of the talk. I gave it on shipboard in the Galapagos Islands, and we were actually under steam when we did it, and so and I was right in the bow, and I literally was running from side to side as we were pitching. So I'm hoping the ground will be a little more stable tonight. This is not something I'm, literature is not something I'm really an expert on at all. I'm not a literary guy. I'm very much a scientist. And funny story, when I first went to Stanford, I was being recruited, and they asked me if I could teach a human nature class. And I was like, human nature, absolutely. That's my bread and butter. That's what I did. I taught that every semester as a grad student. No problem. I got this. I show up at Stanford. I meet with this guy in the German department who's going to talk to me about my human nature class. I thought, that's odd. Why would someone in the German department want to talk to me about human nature? It turns out that I had signed up to teach for this program called the Introduction to the Humanities Program, which had these rules, like you had to read 5 books, and they were supposed to be great books. It was sort of a great books kind of curriculum. I was like, 5 books in one semester? Okay, I think I've read 5 books before. Sure, I can do that. Typically I tend to read papers that are like 3 pages long. That's kind of the nature of science. I managed to do it. I paired with a historian. We had a great class. So tonight, rather than talking deeply about the literature, I'm going to talk about what I know more about, which is the science. And I'm going to talk about a bunch of different varieties of science here. I've been warned that, you know, I'm preaching to the choir when I talk about climate change, but I can't help myself. I need to talk a little bit about it. This is Sao Paulo. It's a city of, my notes aren't here, of 12 million people. It is on a coastal plain, as are three quarters of the world's megacities. These are cities over 10 million people are on coastal plains, okay? 40% of the world's population, as it currently stands, 40% of 7.5 billion people live within 100 kilometers of the coast. This is Dhaka. That's not Dhaka. This is Dhaka. Dhaka is a city of 19 million people. It is not coastal. However, it lies on a triangle in between three rivers, and the rivers all flood annually during the monsoon season. By the end of the century, 50% of Bangladesh, which, bear in mind, is the size of New York State. It's 147,000 square kilometers. It's the size of New York State. It has currently 163 million people in it. 50% of the land area is going to be inundated by the end of the century. Okay, New York City, average height above sea level is 33 feet. The highest point is 265 feet. It is, I don't actually know how many people, I know how many people are in Dhaka, I don't know how many are in New York City. A lot. Yeah, 7 million. Thank you. All right, 7 million apparently. A lot of people, and living in a very vulnerable spot. We currently have an administration under the president who famously, and I don't quite know what the right word for it is. He famously doesn't care about science, is disdainful of science, doesn't want to hear from scientists, despite the fact that we have a growing body of evidence for our own very senses. We have, you know, images of floods. Right, this is the interstate in Houston. Right, we have the tragic fires that we've experienced so nearby ourselves here. Right, as an anthropologist, as a demographer, as someone who thinks about human interactions with the climate, I think about people in motion. Climate change will put people in motion. And the great Pakistani author Mohsen Hamid, you know, talks about, he says, we are all people in motion, right? We're constantly moving, we're coming and going. So I probably got the quote wrong, by the way, because my notes aren't here. But you could. That was one of those things we were supposed to look at when we... Great, thank you. Yeah, that'll be good. I don't need them that much, but for quotes, I do. Turns out we are all migrants. We move through space and time, right? And in a different talk, in a talk where I was talking in a more disciplinary way, talking to you as an anthropologist, talking about anthropological topics, I would talk about how one of the fundamental features of the human adaptation, we are the mobile species. When things get bad, it turns out we move around a lot in our home ranges compared to other things that are a similar size to us, like chimpanzees, or that we're closely related to. But when things get really bad for us, we just up and move continents, and we stay there. It's a remarkable thing that we do, right? So we have a history from the very outset of Homo sapiens of being mobile primates, okay? And I would suggest to you that mobility will be the number one social issue related to climate change, related to pretty much anything in the 21st century going forward. People are fleeing conflict, people are fleeing drought and the collapse of subsistence farming, people are fleeing both. This is a fundamental part of my work right now, and I'm going to talk to you briefly about that after I show you my summary slide for the talk. I like to show the summary at the beginning, because we all think we're going to build this great narrative arc, and we're going to have this denouement, and everyone's going to be hanging on the edge of their seat, and we're going to tell you, you're going to be like, oh, wow, I get it now. It turns out it's way better to tell people what you're going to tell them at the outset. It's So I'm about to do that. Okay. I have 4 points that I'm going to make. Two of them I call them factual, and two of them I call them instrumental. As in, I care about doing something about climate change. I would like to use stories to encourage other people to do things about climate change. Okay? The first factual point is that fiction provides a powerful tool for modeling complex systems. And this is where my science comes in. I'll talk about what I mean by a complex system in a minute and give you a couple sort of passing examples to what I think narrative can do and fiction can do. Stories are more effective than facts at changing people's minds. You can throw facts at people, you can throw facts at the president, right? And they're not going to change their mind. But stories have a chance to. They have to be the right stories. They have to be pitched correctly. They have to be compelling. But they give us a tool for changing people's minds. And that's a factual point. An instrumental point, right, is that fiction allows us to imagine better worlds. This is another Moshin Hamid point, and I think it's really important. I think it's difficult to overstate how important this is for moving forward. And secondly, I think we need a broad diversity of stories. And there's a really interesting bunch of literature that I'll talk about a little bit in the neuroscience of storytelling and listening to stories that supports this idea that we need a broad diversity of stories, of forms, of voices, of people talking about climate change. All right. So I think that narrative is a great way, and particularly long-form narrative, is a great way to model complex systems. What do we mean by a complex system? The canonical model of lynxes and hares, I don't need to point to them, you know which one's the lynx and which one's the hare. It's a fairly simple ecosystem in northern climes in Canada. We've got lynxes on the right, eat hares. And what we see is in the both empirically and theoretically, they tend to cycle, right? And they cycle off in periods that don't completely align with each other. When the hares in the red are very abundant, right? The lynx population grows. It grows so high that it causes the hare population to crash. The hare population crashes, and then there's a little bit of a lag, and then the lynx population crashes because there are no hares to eat. And we keep doing this forever in the theoretical model. We don't do this forever in reality. I like to represent these things in what's called the phase plane. So this is a time series. They're plotted again. Each population is plotted against time. Here we take time out, we make it implicit, and we plot the predators against the prey population, okay? And it's sort of a nicer way, I think, to visualize this. So Alan Hastings is a theoretical ecologist, amazing theoretical ecologist up at the University of California, Davis. And sometime in the early 90s, he was interested in chaos. He works with predator-prey models and these sorts of things. And he added a single species to the classic, this is called the Laca-Volterra model of a predator-prey model. He had a single species with realistic parameters, so you know the like consumption rates, the mortality rates, all the sort of biological parameters that go into it. And what do we get? We get something that looks like this. Now we have three species that we have to plot against each other in their phase planes. But we have, everything gets really crazy. We go from clock-like regularity to something that is, in fact, chaotic, right? So my auto-drawing, yeah. And so the things about complexity that come out of this is that you have tightly coupled systems, right? When you only have one predator and one prey, they're very tightly coupled. The one's livelihood depends on the other. We put a third thing in there, and it kind of throws everything off. It's still tightly coupled. It's also very nonlinear. Right, so the things can change very rapidly in certain regimes, and when you put those two things together, you have the possibility for, depending on just what the right number of things are together, you get very different outcomes, and you get these crazy squiggly phase planes. This is a complex system. coupling, nonlinearity, complexity. Very difficult to make predictions on because it ends up having a great sensitivity to initial conditions. So this is the sort of thing that we work on in my group, and I'm going to tell you a quick story about a pretty crazy line of reasoning. This here is an artist's rendition of the bacterium Neisseria gonorrhea. Anyone want to guess what disease that causes? It's an amazing pathogen, by the way. It's I know it sounds gross. It's incredible. It's an incredible pathogen. I'm happy to talk at length about gonorrhea. I was down in San Diego. My son goes to the University of California, San Diego, and I was at an event, and he called me over to the table. All the parents had dispersed, and he called me over to the table with a bunch of his teammates, and we're talking for maybe 3 minutes, and I say, gonorrhea. And all the boys at the table, a bunch of 20-year-old boys, go, yes! And I'm like, what? Did I just get played? And he's like, yeah, you know, I told him, just watch. You can make him say gonorrhea in less than 5 minutes. So this is gonorrhea. This is Neisseria gonorrhea. And the work that I'm doing with a collaborator, Ashley Hazel, who's another anthropologist, who's worked in my group for a couple years now, we suspect that we have a hypothesis that there's a linkage between climate change and the virulence of this pathogen, like how bad the disease it causes. And it seems kind of like a crazy idea. The place where we're working is Namibia in the southwestern corner of Africa. There's the line. So this is Namibia here. And the region that we're working in, Namibia is the driest country in sub-Saharan Africa. The region that we're working in is called Kakaveld. It's up here in the far northwest, and it is the driest region of Namibia. It is a dry place. And unfortunately, due to the local effects of climate change, it has gotten considerably drier. Southern Africa has had a protracted drought of about 6 years, and the people who live there are exquisitely adapted to a dry climate, but the thing about adaptations to a dry climate is you have to have wet years in order to make up for the bad drought years. But when you have 6 drought years in a row, things start to go asunder. Water's hard to find. These are pastoralist people, and so we've got this historic drought. What do people do? They respond, they adapt, and they adapt the way people have adapted for however long you want to define what people are. I could make an argument, right? 2 million years, 60,000 years, whatever you want to say, right? Whatever critter counts as human, I'm good with that. We've been mobile from that point forward. They move, okay? The pastoralist people of Kakaveld responded as people have always responded. They adapted by changing their mobility. And the thing about changed mobility is it means that you make new contacts, okay? You move, you encounter different people, you move around a greater landscape, you move differently. You move to places you've never seen, you encounter people you've never encountered before, and the epidemiology of directly transmitted pathogens like gonorrhea changes. We typically use mathematical models to explore how this happens, and this is just a simple network model. It's a sexual network where we have just a little bit where people are actually moving for, you know, on average about a week longer than they normally do, and you can just see from left to right the outbreak cluster. The outbreak is the red. It's bigger when people move more, according to the assumptions that we put into the model. So this is the way I normally think about complex systems, but A, there's always a story that we tell that goes under this, right? And this is the logic that links climate change to gonorrhea virulence, is it moves through adaptation, people going about their livelihood business, the social effects of that, and what that implies for the transmission dynamics, and then what the transmission dynamics then imply for the selective forces on virulence, okay? That's the complex system. We've got at least 6 different subsystems linked there. We tell stories about it. We use math, we tell stories. when you write a novel, you have to engage in the process of world building, right? And you have all these linked systems in reality. Just, I mean, this is, we have a reality, of course, but in you know, the New York City reality of Kim Stanley Robinson's New York 2140. This is the cover art from that book. And sea levels have risen by 50 years in a very short period of time. What does this mean for, if they've gone up by 50 feet for a city that's on average 33 feet above sea level, what does this mean? Oh, well, you're gonna have this super Venice city calls it, right? You've got flooding, permanent flooding up to about 46th Street. And what does that mean for how people move about the city? What does that mean for in a rapidly decarbonizing economy where you don't have long distance transport that's as easy? What does that mean for food production? Where do people get their vegetables from? Where do people get their produce from? What does it mean for the governance of small scale organizations like an apartment co-op in New York City, right? These are the types of consequences. You have a global change, you have the effects are felt locally, right? And you have to play out how all these things are gonna work, right? It's a model. It's Kim Stanley Robinson's opinion of what's going to happen. But I don't know. I think he's onto something in most of these things. I know that Anna Lee Newitz spoke recently about, what was she talking about?
Science needs fiction.
Science needs fiction. And she had such a fabulous example of how you have to come to grips with the consequences of your narrative arc. You're like, okay, so she's got this pirate in the Arctic, right, who's on the internet a lot, on shipboard, and then she's like, oh God, where does she get the internet from, right? And so she had to invent something, a technology that provides internet in the Arctic. And you know, this is the notion, you have to flesh out these worlds, you're playing with complex systems. It's actually not a huge point. I mean, well, it's an important point, but it doesn't need to be belabored. This is a fan art for Paolo Bacigalupi's the Wind-Up Girl. And you know, in a decarbonized world, supply chains are going to be highly altered, right? Where do you get your food from? Where's the energy to run manufacturing? Where does that come from? Right? If you have an industrial plant that produces whatever the machines that you're trying to build, where do you get the power to run your machinery? Right? These are all things that come out in the Wind-Up Girl. So that's point number one. Point number two has to do with imagining the future and imagining better worlds. And again, there's this terrific Mohsen Hamid quote, part of the great political crisis we face in the world today is a failure to imagine plausible, desirable futures. We're surrounded by nostalgic visions, violently nostalgic visions. Fiction can imagine differently. I think this is an enormously important idea. And I feel like it probably resonates with anyone who is dissatisfied, say, with the current administration and politics in America. We really are feeling this incredibly violently nostalgic moment. And typically these nostalgias are for things that really didn't happen, or they certainly didn't happen the way we remember them. Memory is an imperfect process. And so by writing fiction, we can imagine a better world. And I think this actually has really important implications for the type of fiction that we should write. And in particular, I took all the slides out of all the ridiculous movies that have dealt with climate, but there are lots of them. You don't have to like think very hard about it. And what's the commonality of them? They're all post-apocalyptic. You know, we love Mad Max and Waterworld, and you know, we didn't love Waterworld, but we love the idea of it, right? These are post-apocalyptic stories, and they're not better futures. Maybe there's some Katniss Everdeen or whoever, you know, comes in and does the heroic thing, and that's interesting. But we're not imagining a better world. I think we need to do better in imagining better worlds. And the thing is, there's plenty of fiction that does exactly that. So that's the good news. Now we have to convince Hollywood and whoever makes TV shows. the great Indian novelist Amitav Ghosh, in addition to a bunch of other literary intellectuals, Richard Powers, Robert McFarlane, Bill McKibben, decry the lack of climate themes in literary fiction. And this is something, honestly, I'm not quite that worried about. Among other reasons, I think we have amazing literary fiction that deals with climate change. We have Barbara Kingsolver's Flight Behavior. We have, of course, Richard Powers himself with, with The Overstory. But I think this sort of questioning of are we hitting the sweet spot for the type of fiction we should be writing raises an important issue. And this has to do with the diversity of the story types and the diversity of the voices who are telling these stories. I like science fiction. Michael likes science fiction. I'm sure many people in this world like science fiction. Not everybody likes science fiction. I don't understand why, but it's true. And so if we have different voices telling stories about people dealing with the consequences of a changed world, we have a better chance of actually reaching people. There's a very interesting body of work in psychology and neuroscience on the neuroscience and the psychology of changing people's minds. And it turns out that when you try to use a story to change someone's mind, in order to the degree of behavior change is proportional to the degree to which the reader or the viewer relates to the central character. Okay? So if you, just instrumentally, if you want to change people's behavior, if you want to make them concerned about climate change, if you want to encourage them to actually take political action, they have to read the story and be able to relate to the character. It's just that simple. And so this argues very strongly, I think, for casting as wide a net as we possibly can in fiction. Getting more diversity, a diversity of voices, a diversity of stories, a diversity of characters, so that these characters can resonate with different groups of people. I've mentioned that we have great literary fiction coming out. I feel like we're doing okay. I can't recommend Flight Behavior enough. I lived in Appalachia for a while, and so it's really not the type of book I normally read. I'm really more of a hard science fiction reader. It moves me. It's amazing. And Richard Powers' book, The Overstory, I'm still coming to grips with it. I finished it a year ago or whenever this summer, and it's messing with my mind still. You know, I think about it a lot. But there are, you know, there's such a great cadre of climate fiction writers, that I'm not that concerned. But I want to continue to push people to think about this from different types of stories. These are more sort of the science fiction types for the most part. From the bottom left, Paolo Bacigalupi, Margaret Atwood, Kim Stanley Robinson, Octavia Butler. Some newer authors, Sam Miller, not as new an author, but new to climate fiction, Maggie G, and of course, San Francisco's own Annalee Newitz. So there's good news, and great news is that a lot of those books are back there that you can peruse. So I feel like the fiction is healthy. We need to push for this diversity of stories that we can have. All right. There we go. We are a highly social species. The term prosocial is used to describe the type of human sociality. And Joe Henrich, an anthropologist at Harvard, has argued quite forcefully that the thing that makes humans smart is not the fact that we are individually smart people, it's the fact that we together are amazing problem solvers. We have a collective intelligence that's pretty unique. And the way we go about this is through social learning. Right? We learn about complex things through social learning. We learn about how to adapt to our world through a process of social learning where we imitate successful people. We have people who teach us. We shamelessly copy. You know, this whole idea, monkey see, monkey do. Monkeys don't see and then do. It's actually a human thing. This idea of being able to copy something. It's us. It's not monkeys. I know it's meant to be a put down. So a key element of social learning is narrative. We tell stories to teach our children. We tell stories to teach each other. And one of the key capacities of learning through narrative is that we have to be able to take perspectives. We have to be able to take different perspectives. And probably a necessary tool for taking others' perspectives is the capacity to have thoughts about thoughts. Okay, this is called metacognition. And when one has thoughts about other people's thoughts, that's what's known as a theory of mind. Okay, and this is a cottage industry in comparative psychology, is figuring out, do orangutans have a theory of mind? They might, chimpanzees don't, gorillas don't seem to, right? It's put whatever you anesthetize. So the classic paradigm for testing apes, by the way, is you put them to sleep, you anesthetize them, and then you paint a yellow dot on their forehead and you give them a mirror. And if when they wake up kind of groggy, they walk over to the mirror and they go, what is that, right? Then they have this self-awareness. It's probably not a perfect paradigm. if you just don't care that there's a dot on your forehead, does it mean you're not self-aware? Okay, sorry. So the theory of mind is probably central to this adaptation that we have, this learning through narrative, telling people stories. And Darwin had thoughts on this. All sentient beings develop through natural selection in such a way that pleasant sensations serve to guide, and especially the pleasure derived from sociability and from loving our families. Right? That selection favors social goods being pleasurable, right? And drives us to doing more things like that. So theory of mind is probably a very important part of what makes humans human. It allows us to learn socially. And a big part of learning socially is about telling stories that teach us. I'm going to talk a little bit for the next couple minutes on some neuroscience of storytelling and learning about stories. And let me see my notes here. Yep, all right. When you read a story, we're going to come back to the theory of mind bit, right? It actually ties in. When you read a story, this is simply here to cue me to say that we have the somatosensory cortex runs right down along here, right along the postcentral gyrus. And you've seen it drawn as a homunculus, you know, the greatly exaggerated hand and nose and mouth and the huge lips, right? This is where all these projections happen. These are the parts of your brain that deal with sensory perception and movement in your body. When you read a story, and you're following along the action of the character, and you're engaged in the story. And that's a really important caveat. You have to actually be engaged in the story. When you're engaged in the story and you're reading along, we see that the somatosensory cortex fires like crazy, as though you're living through the actions and the feelings and the lived experience of the character. This is really interesting. It's really important. You're not obviously actually experiencing this. And this is actually, it turns out to be very, very similar to dream state, right? When you're dreaming, you're actually, your brain is actually sending signals and you're flying by flapping your wings or something. Suppose you have wings. Your brain is telling your arms to move, but they're not because you're in a paralyzed state, right? So this is a similar type of reading paralysis, right? You're experiencing this while reading, while not actually literally experiencing it. And some of the activation of our brains, different parts of our brains, different networks in our brains, is surprisingly long-lasting. Some of it just happens while you're reading it. Some of it lasts longer. This is a very complicated figure, and I didn't make it. And it's always hard to try to explain other people's very complicated figures. but the thing I want to draw your attention to are these plots here. The brains are distracting, I know. But the plots, this is a correlation between activity, the activity that you're doing, and these different circuits that are highlighted here lighting up in the imagery. And what we see is that on the left, this is the perspective-taking network, and when you read the story, so in this capacity, in this experiment, people went in every day and had these things measured. They read a story for a week, and they were measured then, and then they were measured after reading the story as well. And what we see is that the correlation goes up. It's significant. It's a big difference. It may not look dramatic, but it goes up. And this is the perspective-taking networks of the brain that are lighting up while reading the story. What's remarkable is that this, on the other hand, is the somatosensory cortex. This is that bit about the lived experience of the characters. And while it certainly goes up, and it actually looks like it goes up a little more dramatically, it stays up. It stays up for days, sometimes as much as weeks. And so this suggests that there's a powerful embodiment that goes on when you read stories that you're engaged in. And I think that this is the sort of thing that if we're going to think instrumentally about using fiction, these are the sorts of things that we have to look for. What are the things that have lasting impact? I have some more ideas about the perspective taking, but I'll never finish if I don't. The amazing thing is, it's not just changes in our own brains, though, when we read a story. It turns out that when I tell a story and you listen to the story, again, if you're engaged, our brains actually will sync up. And this is part of this amazing sociality that we have and the fact that our intelligence is tied to being social. Uri Hassan at Princeton has done amazing work showing that people, the same regions, so they put them in functional scanners, right? And they look at what regions are firing, and people will synchronize what's happening, the storyteller and the listener to the story. And this is a remarkable feature, I think. Goes way back to that really interests me is this notion of distributed cognition, right? And this is an idea that the anthropologist at UCSD, Edwin Hutchins, coined in the 80s, and he was studying the amazing South Pacific navigators. Here we've got some navigators, some sailors in the Trobriand Islands where he worked. You know, these guys would set out, and the chance of you just randomly going out and finding an island in the Pacific are pretty infinitesimal. And these guys did it all the time, and they did it through a remarkable coordination of what Hutchins then coined as this distributed cognition, which he then took to study the bridges of aircraft carriers and flight crews and the sorts of things. So I feel like there's some really interesting neuroscience lurking here to talk about coordination of behavior and getting people literally on the same team to solve common problems here. All right. I was 15 feet from this guy, but I was safely in a Land Rover, right? If I had not been, I would have been a little stressed out, right? My adrenal cortex would have been squirting out cortisol, the stress hormone, right, as I saw this guy. This is an adaptive response. We undergo some sort of acute stressor. Our adrenal glands go into action. They squirt cortisol. We get in a physiological state that prepares us for the sorts of things that we're likely to have to do to adapt to the stressor. Okay, one of the truly remarkable things about reading a story is that, and again, when you're engaged with the story, you get a major activation of your HPA axis, your hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal axis. This is the classic stress response. It's the system that regulates stress, but it's also essential in the control of the immune system, mood, and sexuality and energy, right? And I think that this is the foundation, the physiological foundation of that feeling when you're engaged in a story and you're really nervous. I mean, reading Flight Behavior, I'm just so anxious about what's going to happen to Della Robbia again, you know, because what new humiliation of being poor in America is she going to have to endure, right? And it's that feeling of needing to turn the page. This is this activation of the HPA axis, okay? It's cool. Is it useful instrumentally? And I have to give props out to my Stanford colleague, Robert Sapolsky. Many of you are probably familiar. But he's an incredible, incredible public speaker and a huge intellect. Has been a good mentor to me. Why do we care about cortisol other than it's kind of cool that you get this physiological response to reading a story? It turns out that stress opens people's minds to behavior change. The right kind of stress opens people's minds to behavior change. University College London psychologist, neuroscientist, Tali Sharot, is most famous. She has a fairly recent book on changing people's minds. And she's quite famous for her technical work on what's called a positivity bias. Okay, so that you're faced with information that comes at you from the world. You have prior beliefs about what the world is like. And when you get information that's good news relative to your desires, you take that and you say, good, my hypothesis is supported. And when you get bad news, you kind of ignore it. You don't pay as much attention to it, which seems a little paradoxical. It seems like for a survival algorithm, you'd want to learn more from bad news. That's the way I think about these things. But it turns out that isn't the way a lot of people go about doing it. Until you put them under stress. When you put people under stress, when you give them some sort of, like one of these psychologists, sort of like funny things that you do, you tell them that they're going to have to give a public lecture after they do your test or something like that. It turns out you open people's minds to both good news and bad news. And they behave like proper Bayesians. They update their priors in a rational kind of way. Isn't that cool? And that means that they've had their HPA access activated. It means that they've got that cortisol response. And that's exactly what good fiction does to you. Is it possible that there's a physiological foundation for good fiction changing people's valence bias, right? Their willingness to accept good and bad news? It's a hypothesis. I want to talk about one last thing before wrapping up, which is some really cool work that I've encountered by a couple political scientists, Inga Haas and Bill Cunningham, I think. Haas and Cunningham, 2014. And I was looking for pictures that I could use to highlight cultishness. My name is Jamie Jones, right? James is my given name. Many people would go with Jim. But I'm a certain vintage such that Jim Jones turns out to be... Let's just say you don't want to take Kool-Aid from me. No one ever did. And I thought about putting a Jim Jones, but I just feel like it's kind of in bad taste. But there's a remarkable body of psychological research that deals with what people do, and you know, you tend to associate this with millenarian cults. You know, the end is nigh. The world is going to end on January 29th at 9 p.m. We've got 40 minutes, people, right? And then it doesn't end, right? And that seems like it would be devastating for your belief system, right? But it turns out, amazingly, it usually isn't. And so how can that possibly be? And that's actually really bad news if we're trying to change people's minds in an instrumental way, okay? So the cool work that they've done, and it relates to my interest in decision science and uncertainty, they have this model. It's my only like sort of academic-y model here. It turns out that when you have a lot of uncertainty, and bear in mind, we have a ton of uncertainty about climate change. We have real epistemic uncertainty about what's going to happen, right? What the magnitude of things is. We have a lot of real scientific uncertainty. We also have a climate, as it were, where highly motivated groups of people are trying to increase the uncertainty, right? They want to really highlight the fact, just like the cigarette companies, the tobacco companies did, the oil companies now are trying to highlight the uncertainty. So we have uncertainty. And then the question is there a threat? This is, how do people respond to uncertainty? If there is no threat, it turns out that your brain opens up and you're willing to explore new ideas. If you are threatened, and the threat here is about the threat to your identity, right? The threat to your core identity. If your core identity is threatened, if people say, you know, the world didn't end and your cult says it was going to, you say, oh, well, our praying worked and we've gotten a reprieve. So we're going to keep doing what we've been doing and you guys should probably do it too. Defensive closed-mindedness, okay? So this is another reason, I think, why we need to think about the types of narratives we put out there and associate with climate change. Do we want them all to be about, you know, there not being any landmass on the Earth? Do we want them to be about a fiery hellscape? We can be realistic, but we want to think carefully about how we use fear as a tool for motivating people, because fear frequently leads to retrenchment. So let me just wrap up by talking about, you know, the three things. I just love it. You know, here we are. We're right in Starbase Starfleet Academy. I mean, it's got to be like right next door, right? I guess it's in the Marin Headlands, but whatever. You know, so I just said science fiction. Climate fiction allows us to imagine better worlds. And we're not going to work towards a better world if we can't imagine a better world. So let's get out there and tell stories about the possibility of our human futures. Something that climate change or climate fiction is really good for. Shared experience. God, man. Remember when? The day I learned Tony Bourdain died, I went and slurped some pho and drank some beer down in Sunnyvale, because there's no such thing in Palo Alto. And I thought long and hard about this scene. God, it's so beautiful. Shared experience, right? Fiction, stories, narratives, they allow us to put together a shared experience. And this is another really important thing about convincing people about that you're right and they're wrong. That, you know, you'd think you want to focus on the facts that you differ on. In fact, what you really want to do is focus on the things that you agree on. Once you establish a rapport of a shared experience, that's when you can begin to do the hard work of negotiating people's differences. Okay, so fiction gives us a mechanism for inducing these shared experiences. And then, more speculatively, Robert with his baboon friend, stress opens your mind to different types of information. And if we can write engaging narratives that get people turning pages and get people caring about the characters, we might have a hope of actually getting rid of some of these cognitive biases that seem to get in the way of taking real action on climate change. I try to be an optimistic person, but I have to admit it's hard sometimes. And I find Gramsci's idea here really motivating, written from an Italian prison cell, right? Pessimism of the intellect. You know, imagine the worst case scenario, but optimism of will. We have to imagine that future because the alternative really isn't so great. And I want to end just with Ursula Le Guin, who is so unbelievably tied up. I can't even begin to tell you how tied up she is in so much of what I've said in weird ways that you don't even know. But she says, I think hard times are coming when we'll be wanting the voices of writers who can see alternatives to how we live now and can see through our fear-stricken society and its obsessive technologies to other ways of being and even imagine some real grounds for hope. We will need writers who can remember freedom, poets, visionaries, the realists of a larger reality. Amen. Thanks. Okay, now let's step out of the way.
Come right back up. Thank you, Jamie. We don't have too much time, but I thought at this point a great thing to have would be to ask one of our favorite science fiction writers and recent long now speaker, Hanu Rajanimi is here, an actual science fiction writer in the real world. Give a round of applause, and maybe you've got a couple chances if you're up for it to chat a little bit with Jamie.
Yeah.
Jamie, thank you so much for a very passionate and wonderful talk. I felt I learned an enormous amount and feel very inspired to write some climate fiction.
Nice.
So your job is
what was it? Was it the shared experience or was it the stress of sitting in the front row? Or
no, I think actually the fact that you tie it so beautifully to our evolutionary past as well, how and I think nothing could be appropriate if we use this superpower that evolution has given us for thinking about the future to actually, you know, save our evolutionary future. Just a few thoughts though. You emphasize a lot the role of the novel or sort of prose and fiction. And of course, I completely agree with you that it's a very, very powerful medium and perhaps unique in the sense that it gives us this interiority of another person and sort of puts us directly inside their heads. But of course, there are many people in the world who do not read novels. And there has been this slow decline of the literary novel in terms of popularity. And I'd be curious to hear your thoughts on what other mediums could be more accessible, more powerful. I mean, computer games come to mind to me, given that we are dealing with complex systems, and games are an inherently systemic medium where you can tweak parameters and play with things. And of course, they put us directly right in the center of action. So just wondering if you have any thoughts on that.
No, I do, and that's a great point. You know that there is not a giant reading public. And this is one of the facts that I think actually argues for the importance of continuing on the science fiction element of Cli-Fi, which is that there's always the hope if you write some really great, like just completely like bitchin' story about dragons and climate change and spaceships coming to Earth or whatever, that HBO is going to make the next Game of Thrones, right? I mean, the reach of that would be extraordinary. And I would love to see people in the visual media, I don't know what you call that, movies and TV shows, you know, more engaged with this. It's another point that's sort of a side point, and I'll get to more of what you were asking about. If you look at representations of scientists, and if you look at representations of civil servants in movies, they're almost across the board negative. And one of the remarkable things about, well, there are a couple remarkable things about the movie Arrival is that Amy Adams and Jeremy Renner were unmitigated heroes, right? And they're real academics, they're real scientists. And Renner, I mean, it's kind of an amazing thing. He actually learned something from, the physicist learned something from the linguist, and he's like, yeah, you've got it, right? And I mean, there's a lot to be said for that type of representation. I think we need a lot more of it. It's also remarkable that they made that incredible short story into a movie, and it was a good movie. Regarding video games, I'm not a gamer, but I think that there's a lot to be said there. My concern is that it reaches a very specific audience still. Like it isn't a broad. I mean, lots of people play games, but this tends to be middle class, mostly white kids in you know the U.S. and Europe and. You know, those are people we need to reach, absolutely. It would be cool to figure out how we could get this technology more broadly used. My colleague at Stanford, Jeremy Bailenson, does virtual reality work on sort of giving people experiences in environmental situations. You know, you go into his lab and you go like this and you can feel your hand chopping down a tree. And it turns out that people like trees more afterwards. So I think that there's a lot of amazing potential. It would be great to figure out how we could make it as broad as possible, though. That's probably good for that question, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think the book, even the paper book, remains like this incredible cheap medium that doesn't require any power and that can reach everywhere. Another thing I found myself thinking about was... what would it be like to write a story from the point of view of a climate change skeptic? So sort of like those very fundamentalist Christian movies where that have an atheist character who then experiences a miraculous conversion, or maybe not. But
yeah.
I was curious if there has been any neuroscientific research on how people react to stories about characters who have very opposite views to themselves, or does that they are too different from me?
That's a great question. I wish I knew the answer to that, and I'll have to look more. Solar, right? Who wrote Solar?
McEwen.
Ian McEwen. I my sense is that there's an element of that in Solar. It's a really cool idea, and it would be the sort of thing. So, some of you may have seen Shaz Atari's talk here at the Interval. And she's really interested in she's more on the you know lab psychology sort of end of this, trying to figure out what are the elements of stories that get people to want to take action on climate related issues, and this seems like the sort of thing that would be really ripe for Shaz or people she's working with to take up, like. Do you get a measurable effect of having an antagonist actually make a conversion?
And maybe one final question would be, real quick, is what do you think are best examples of fiction really changing people's minds historically?
Yeah.
If you have any favorite examples of that kind.
My wife is a Civil War historian, and Uncle Tom's Cabin has got to be, you know, it's the prototype for this type of socially relevant literature. You know, it's not great literature, right? It's kind of a schmaltzy story. But it had a big effect. My daughter has been suggesting to me that The Grapes of Wrath is a sort of early climate fiction. You know, you've got these displaced people. They're moving bodies across a landscape. They're fleeing largely a climatic event, and you see the just horrible lives they lead, and the consequences of this broken environment. I don't know if that had its intended effect. Another interesting one is Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, you know, writing about the meatpacking industry. And what's interesting, and this is something that Michael has cautioned me on a couple times, you know, the unintended consequences, right? They're complex systems. We don't know, with different initial conditions, we might get different results. And Sinclair was writing this book, you know, from the perspective of the workers. When people read it, they got really upset about the food, how safe the food was. It's like, well, yeah, that too, but also the workers. So those are a couple examples. I mean, you know, something like Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, it isn't really fiction, but I mean, it starts off with a scenario, right? I mean, I think if we thought hard about it, we could come up with a lot of these things. But as I said, I'm not a literary guy.
Honey, before you, while we've got you up here, so most of your published work hasn't been focused on climate. I think there's some, you know, a few things in there, but I think you said you've got something that you have worked on and you've looked at. I'm curious both what have you thought about and what attracts you as far as aspects around climate change to write about, that you've thought about or might be working on, and also as a reader, because you've probably read more science fiction than the two of us put together, what are some of the things that you've seen authors do in a Cli-Fi space that stand out to you and why?
So I'm really just dabbling in this sphere right now. I have a novella I've been working on for a while, on and off, which I actually hope to finish sometime this year, called Brother's Milk, which touches upon very much the human mobility and survival aspects. There's this pop-up village or pop-up city in desertified southern Italy with various displaced peoples trying to survive. There's a political entity that they have to deal with called the Green Caliphate, which is radicalized Islam, which is also very, 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 very pro-environment. So I'm kind of interested in paradoxical or seemingly contradictory combinations of ideologies that could emerge in some of these possible futures. In terms of what I've seen, I think Jamie did a great job of mentioning a few examples. I also think short stories in general are a great format for science fiction in general. And there's a few anthologies. There's one I really like called Solar Punk, is Solar Punk is a name some people have given to a hopeful Cli-Fi genre, so I recommend you check out that one. There's an older anthology that has similar themes called Shine, which is more broader than climate, but also does a great job of outlining some very optimistic and yet engaging futures. So there's some examples.
That's great.
There's the new one that just came out, the new anthology, like literally came out today. I got an email about it.
So Arizona State, some friends of ours at Arizona State University let us know, and we'll be posting this on our social media for long now. It just came out today. It's free, a downloadable ebook. It's actually the second edition that they've done. Both have been actually fiction writing contests that have been judged by science fiction writers. Kim Stanley Robinson did this latest one, and it looks really cool. I'm blanking on the name right now, but we'll put it out there, and like I said, it's free, so definitely check that out. I'll give a big round of applause to Hanu. Thank you so much for jumping in here. And we do want to sneak in, we're running a little bit over, but we do want to sneak in a couple of your questions. So Roseanne's got the mic, please get her attention. I wanted to ask you, it's interesting that people need to be under stress to open up the possibility of switching tracks, as it were, and change their mind to this stuff. Is massive fear of climate change going to bring us all into that state? I guess I guess maybe one of the things that I'm going to put forward is that, and someone has said this, I'm sorry not to be able to fully quote it, but all fiction is going to be climate fiction in the very near future because it's going to be more of a reality that we're dealing with.
Yeah.
And it already
That's Annalise said that.
Yeah, Annalise said, yeah. So I knew it sounded familiar. And so Salvage the Bones, which is about Katrina, yeah. the wake of Katrina. Anything that's dealing with some of these massive weather disasters are inherently doing that. And in a way, you know, I don't think we touched on Stan's notion, Kim Stanley Robinson's notion of the of looking at both the present time and looking at a possible future, but in a way, those two. So any future that we're looking at is also reflecting the moment that we're in, and as those two in near term future sci-fi or cli-fi are super close. Inherently, we're probably going to identify with those people more, which is one of the other conditions, you think. Any thoughts on that?
Lots of thoughts. I mean, it's dangerous to write about the near term, yeah. right? It's harder in a lot of ways. If you write about people 3,000 years in the future, but for all we know, we've sprouted wings by that point. We can fly to the stars. Right, whereas there has to be enough continuity if you're writing about, say, 20, 50 years in the future, that it seems realistic and that the feel of it is right, but a lot's going to change. So I think it's a real technical challenge for the futurist, and I completely agree that, you know, Margaret Atwood, right, said it's not climate change, it's everything change. And when the world is in these tightly coupled systems, you know, you throw something big at the sort of top level system, it's going to have cascading effects and ramifying effects, not just cascading as in coming down, but ramifying as in going side to side and having just huge effects. If we want to write about the present anytime from now to the future, the climate background has probably got to be in there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We've got a question right here. There we go.
So also related to this stress thing, one of the common things just in talking about climate is to give people a few little things they can do to release their stress. And so without having the stress of thinking about the big picture, even seeing the system. So I wonder if just sort of in the generic kind of climate community conversation, if you have thoughts about the jump to give people little solutions, if that's a short-circuiting of that stress, or how do you perceive that?
Yeah, I mean, this is another thing that Tali Sharot talks about, is giving people, empowering people and feeling like they have some control, and that they're much more willing to sort of engage in behavior change if they feel like they have control. So I think that's a really important, an important feature of any sort of strategy for getting people to take action. I mean, I guess the concern is you want the things that people do to feel like they're in control to be meaningful. And you know, if like I feel good about recycling plastic, but, you know, China isn't taking plastic anymore, and so it's actually ending up in the ocean, you know, it might be somewhat self-defeating there. So, absolutely. And that actually, your mentioning stress reminded me of the other part of your question. That, you know, Robert Sapolsky talks at length about the difference between chronic and acute stress, right? And acute stress is the stuff that's good for us. It's why we exercise. It's why we read fiction and get engaged, and why we like that, why we keep going back to it. And, you know, just constant doom and gloom. I'm all for realism, but the constant doom and gloom that puts us under this continual chronic stress is not the way to change people's behavior. So
getting kind of a bolt of an experience, singular experience, as opposed to being terrorized, essentially.
As opposed to being in a low-grade, constant terror.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. How's everybody feeling out there tonight? we got another question over here, I think. Hi, thanks.
So people often don't feel stress unless they're in the situation, so stress seems more less effective as a proactive rather than a reactive approach.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how effective stress would be as like premeditative. And then the second part of my question is, you tie in a lot about evolutionary psychology as a way to kind of help people resonate with the story so that they take action on it. But evolutionary psychology and natural selection, I mean, most people take the path of least resistance, and most people are selfish. How is that, how can you leverage and utilize that for something like advocating for social good, like climate change?
Yeah, that's a great question. I guess I would challenge the idea that we're fundamentally selfish. There's an enormous body of research that's building right now, talking about the fact that, and so people who've talked about this, Sam Bowles has a recent book on this. He's an economist. And I wish I could remember the name of it. It's a fabulous book on basically arguing that economic incentives aren't enough to encourage good behavior, but it turns out the good news is that people actually want to engage in good behavior. People are pro-social under the right circumstances. And so I guess that's the key, right, is to make it under the right circumstances. People have to be engaged in their communities. It also helps if you don't tell them that people are fundamentally these neoliberal agents who are constantly out there trying to maximize their economic utility and say, yeah, actually there's a place for social good and for morality in these sort of things. So I actually find the current work in evolutionary studies very hopeful in that regard. I'm sorry, the first part of your question. Oh, right. And this is the amazing thing about the sort of neuroscience of reading stories and watching stories. And it's something I'd like to see a more robust literature on. Like that, we need more research on this because, you know, we were simultaneously, as I'm telling you about all these cool results of neuroscience, I'm also dealing with the fact that there's this thing called the replication crisis or the replicability crisis, right? That 85% of medical studies are underpowered and can't be replicated, and it's about the same for psychology as well, right? So it would be nice to have a more robust sort of body of work saying this, but from what I can tell, there is strong evidence that the reading of a story, the telling of a story, the comprehension of a story puts you in that state that's as though you're experiencing it. Obviously a little safer, right? You don't have that lion right there, but it seems to me like that's promising for putting you in the state for changing, being open to changing your mind.
Thanks. All we're going to be able to have for questions right now, but you're going to stick around.
Yeah, of course.
And there was a lot. I know there's a lot that we didn't even touch on and background on what's there, so I hope you'll stick around. I want to give a quick shout out, first of all, to Borderlands, who are in the back. Those are who are in the room.
Yeah. Local bookstores.
Everyone here knows they covered our chime generator table with like literally dozens of books and probably close to two dozen titles or more of climate fiction of various sorts. That's a list that you've been compiling and in dialogue with Borderlands to some extent. You are going to be publishing that list just on your blog and we'll
yeah.
be sending it out there. So keep an eye out for that. I also want to mention, so Shazeen Atari's talk, which you mentioned is on our website, on the Interval site. We'll also send out a link to that. And you mentioned Jeremy Bailenson's work at Stanford about VR and empathy. And Kara Platoni, who's spoken for us, she talks a bit about that work in her talk that she gave for us. And a couple other things you've talked about, I think we're going to be talking about later on this year as well. So keep an eye on what we're doing here for this. Jamie, as far as this work goes and what you're thinking about next, and I mean, I can't, just to put it in context again, I mean, this is not your primary work. It's very much kind of a passion project that brings some of your work into other other interests. So are you going to continue this? Do you have a sense of what the life of this is going to be?
I have a feeling it could take over my life if I'm not careful. I'm sure Hanu has thoughts on that. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, yeah, maybe. I have this unpublishable paper, right, that I've been working on. I write it. I was like, where the hell am I going to publish this? My God, because it's not an essay like for I don't know the Atlantic or something, some sort of. But it's kind of academic, but it's like not. So I don't know. We'll see what the reception is, I guess.
I think this is.
I respond to positive reinforcement. Right?
All right. I think we can get a bunch of that in a second. I have to say, this is also kind of the fourth kind of my favorite talk, on top of the other three that I mentioned earlier, because it's the kind of talk of like
I've hit a home run.
Remember that talk about climate science fiction? Yeah, yeah. But remember that one talk about the guy who was really into gonorrhea.
Same guy.
All things, the eclecticism of this talk in and of itself, people will realize later they're talking about the same talk. Can we get some positive reinforcement for tonight's speaker, please?
Thank you.
And as Jamie knows, because he keeps coming back here, we have a long now challenge coin for you as a thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Hanu, I'm going to give you your second one for bravely stepping up here. And because you're a three-timer and I want to do something a little bit special, this is a Stuart Brand autographed copy of The Clock for the Long Now.
Oh, wow, cool.
that he signed for you.
Thank you.
So, you know, just to encourage you all to hit the triple crown here at... at interval as well. One more big round of applause, and thank you guys for coming out and being a great audience.
Thanks.